General Shaketka, President of the Forum for Integrated National Security, acronymed FINS, Chairman DRDO, Dr. Satish Reddy, Professor Suhas Pednekar, the Vice Chancellor of the University of Mumbai, Advocate Bal Desai, Secretary General FINS. We have also amongst us Sri Utpal Parrikar, who was just introduced to you. Present here is GOC Maharashtra and Gujarat area, General Patil. Of course, we have veterans from the services, amongst us Admiral Karve and others, officers from the services fraternity, members of the faculty and staff of the University of Mumbai, distinguished invitees who are present here today, my very dear students from this university, from various faculties, ladies, gentlemen, and friends for the media. At the very outset, a very good evening and a warm welcome to all of you. I am indeed honored and privileged to be present here on the inaugural Mr. Parrikar Memorial Lecture, which is being organized by FINS, which is a very insightful and thoughtful think tank, which is known for its rigorous and hard-nosed analysis of our security challenges. And I think it has very aptly been covered by General Shaketkar when he mentioned about what this institution is doing. They are indeed spreading awareness of national security amongst our people. Why are we here today at the University of Mumbai? It is because in the military we understand that national security can no longer remain in the domain of the defense services alone. Threats to national security are becoming complex day by day, and therefore it is important that we adopt a whole of nation approach. Every person, every citizen of our country must be involved in our nation's security. We do know that the spirit of nationalism is present in each one of you, and this is something that we must cultivate so that we ensure holistic national security for our nation. And I am very grateful to General Shaketkar for having given me this invite today. Talking about Sri Manohar Parrikar, well, my first interaction with him began when I was commanding a corps in the East, which is 3 corps with the headquarters in Nagaland, responsible for the northeastern states. And I remember him just calling me up and saying, "Rawat, I believe there is something you are doing across the borders in Myanmar." And I said, "Yes, sir, there is something that has been planned and will be executed very soon." And all he said was, "I am confident you will succeed. And if you succeed, the glory is yours and that of the troops who will be participating in the operations. But should things go wrong, which I am quite confident will not happen, the responsibility will be mine." And with that, he just put the phone down even before I could respond. And that is how started my journey with Mr. Parrikar. 48 hours later, the operation had been completed. And I remember it was around 5:30 in the evening when I was given a message that Mr. Parrikar would again like to speak to you. And he picked up the phone again and he said, "The glory is yours and that of your men. Please convey my best wishes to every member who participated in this operation." And he again put the foot down. And that was all. Thereafter, of course, I came to Southern Command as the Army Commander in Pune. Got opportunities to interact with him regularly. And then, of course, as the Vice Chief and subsequently as the Chief of the Army Staff. Well, he was known for his political acumen. But as a Raksha Mantri, when we got associated with him, we did feel that here was a person with outstanding qualities of head and heart. He had a very curious mind, a military scientific temper. I think that because he was a graduate from the Indian Institute of Technology and a metallurgist at all. And how did I get to know that he was a metallurgist? I had not read much about him. Well, we were in the field. We had some tanks where we had indigenously manufactured some of the radiators for these tanks, and we were out on the exercise in the deserts when the tanks started overheating. These tanks, of course, are the T-90 tanks imported from Russia, manufactured in India with Russian design. The radiators were so far being imported, but we had decided to make our own radiators at Awadi. And the Indian radiators started overheating. And when this problem was brought out to him, he said, "I would like to go and see these tanks in the field." And so we took him to a place near Jaipur. He went there, spent 40 minutes and said, "The problem is your metallurgy." And he said, "Just look at the metallurgy of the radiator and you will be able to get the problem solved." And the problem was solved in exactly 90 days thereafter. Problem was with the metallurgy. So this is the quality that he had, identifying a problem, reaching out to the field, giving you a solution, and that was the end state. Of course, it has been brought out that he was an extremely simple man with pragmatism. And when I talk of his simplicity, when I see Utpal sitting here, he used to be dressed exactly like him, except that Utpal is wearing kegs, he always wore sandals. And of course, he had his trademark reading glasses always hanging around his neck, ever ready to read any paper. I do remember sometime the media telling him as to, "Why do you dress in this manner?" And he said, "Why? What is wrong with my dressing sense?" They said, "It is too simple for a politician." Well, I can understand that when you work 60 to 18 hours a day, you have to be dressed comfortably. You can't be suited, booted, and then perform 16 hours a day. Because I have seen him perform 16 hours a day. As was mentioned, I've had breakfast meetings with him in his house on the same table where Satish Reddy had at 6 in the morning, at 8 in the morning, and dinner with him at 8:30 and 9 on the same table. And yet continued to work till about midnight. So I have seen a man here who can work 16 to 18 hours a day without rest. And I know while traveling in the aircraft, he could take 40 winks just relaxing on the seat and then be fresh again. He was well read, and I think one of the books was also brought out by General Shekhetkar, but I remember he would always quote from a book called The Victory on the Potomac and Robert Greene's 33 Strategies for War, because he would often quote from these books. So, you know, not only was he a political thinker, but also a military strategist, which we learned from the way he had started interacting with us. He had a very deep insight of global developments, and he always quoted from experiences of others. He developed a truly Indian defense ecosystem, and as Dr. Satish Reddy brought out, he was the author of the IDDM, the Indigenously Designed, Developed and Manufactured Model for bringing in indigenization in our industry, especially in the defense industry. I think what is important today, if we are looking at the future, 10 years from now, 2030, we have to look at the strengths of our DRDO, of our private sector, of our MSMEs, of our startups, and our DPSUs. All these have tremendous capacity to develop the indigenous industry in defense manufacturing. all we have to do is integrate each one with the other. All of them working in silos would not work. And with them, very closely, has to be associated the defense services. Only then can we succeed. We have the capacities, we have the capabilities, all we need to do is encourage the industry, encourage our research and development organizations, encourage our small entrepreneurs who are growing up, producing startups, and of course the DPSUs. And this is what is propelling some of our schemes and will continue to do so. Therefore, General Mr. Parrikar had set the stage for a professional and technologically enabled military, one cast in the Indian mold, which he dreamt of. And I think we are on that path of glory, and I think a lot of credit for that will go to him. So when I today talk about Indian defense perspective in 2030, we talk about the trajectory of India's defense paradigm over the next decade that will be shaped significantly by the vision of Mr. Parrikar. So let's get on to the main topic of our talk, talking about perspective 2030. Well, such a perspective has to be predicated on an incisive survey of the threats and opportunities that line India's security path. The many strategic uncertainties that we will need to grapple with. An examination of the strategic concept, so to speak, and that will be my first port of call. I will then try and explore the challenges that lie ahead for our defense and what we need to do over the next decade. We are in fact doing a lot of this already. We need to have a relook at our doctrinal thought, our structural reorganization, optimization of our resources, creation of a very sound defense ecosystem in our country, develop technological leadership, the strategic military capability that we need to face the challenges over the next decade must be addressed in perspective. And finally, I shall outline why a rather bullish and optimistic about the deliverance that I am will ensure the envisioned goals and objectives. I do understand that we have the constraints of time, but nonetheless, I will try and cover the events through my random thoughts. The principal challenges that we have today before the Indian defense is to become a part of our aspirational climb towards a $5 trillion economy, as also the creation of an inclusive and equitous socio-economic order at home. We must make sure that our economic flight is calibrated with the span of our strategic stride. We must temper our military ambitions with the size of our economy and the budgetary allocation that we receive. We must cut the cloth to size. Too many tight-fitting garments will not suit us, and oversized garments will only lead to avoidable expenditures. But may I assure you that we are actively engaged in just this endeavor. Maintenance of strategic balance across domains, that is through diplomacy, deterrence and war fighting, through convergence of cross-governmental capacities, therefore remains one of our key priorities. It will also seem to me that the structure of the world order is undergoing profound transformation. Change is upon us like never before, and we must understand and see into it that we understand what the change is going to do to us. Many trends that are sweeping the global landscape, let me pick on just a few of relevance to the subject at hand. One is the finesse with which some of the old empires like Russia, Iran, Turkey, just to name a few, are skillfully leveraging hard power to reclaim lost geostrategic space. And we are doing likewise, meshing hard power into our statecraft with care and resolve so as to fortify our national security posture. As you would have seen in our recent responses to the provocation that we have faced along our western borders. We shall continue to act and not react. Secondly, what determines power and international standing today is no longer the same. Technology, connectivity, and trade are at the heart of new constellations. Diplomacy and hard security are indeed fusing like never before, necessitating a whole of government response to the emerging challenges. Thirdly, and most significantly, I wish to draw the attention of this gathering to some of the sweeping changes that are possibly occurring across the strategic military landscape with major implications for global security calculus. The manner in which we approach these challenges and fashion our responses will be critical. Over the last couple of years, we have seen some pointed evidence to suggest that the metrics of deterrence and war fighting have indeed moved on further. Some thought leaders opine that the space for all-out conflict is narrowing and that we have entered an era of non-war wars and durable disorder, whereby the world may not collapse in anarchy, as Samuel Huntington thought so in his book, The Clash of Civilizations, but will simmer in perpetual conflict. In terms of ideational thought, Sun Tzu suggested, is steadily elbowing out Clausewitz's lion philosophy. In the worldview of Clausewitz, cunning ruses are the weapons of the weak. But for Sun Tzu, whom the Chinese proclaim as their guru, they are legitimate weapons for choice. For Clausewitz, the big battlefield victories, big bang technologies, and consequently, billion-dollar budgets were everything. But for Sun Tzu, posits, there are smarter ways to secure a competitive advantage. So we have to see which of these two we need to adapt. The concept of utilitarian leveraging of force also needs to be revisited in the obtaining strategic context. Force has numerous stabilizing uses, hard and soft in equal measure. It helps keep the peace. It gives the practitioners of diplomacy a robust veneer. It deters. It is a useful tool for politico-military signaling. It is a critical component for the protection and altering the geostrategic spaces, a means of buying influence and influencing behavior, a conduit for the delivery of humanitarian aid, and when employed sagaciously and resolutely, a decisive arbiter in conflict. When wrapped in imaginative statecraft, its leverage as a metric in the resolute pursuit of national interest across the utility spectrum cannot be overemphasized. Strategic foreign policy objectives today are being achieved through the smart leveraging of military pressure point without a shot being fired. Force is being used increasingly to facilitate political settlements rather than fashion outright victory. We are examining as to how we in the context of India could leverage force more productively in this critical arena, what some observers call gray zone warfare, and are chalking out an approximate response strategy duly resourced. Such an endeavor, may I add, is without prejudice to our larger project of conventional preparedness. As was very rightly also brought out by General Shekhetkar, that while you should be prepared for everything, it does not mean that you invite war. But preparedness brings in deterrence. India is a country with a rich homegrown and well-honed strategic culture embellished in our ancient text, the Arthashastra, and the Yuddhakandam, which is the manual of war, which pronounces with great wisdom and strategic savvy on various aspects of our statecraft. So very many people who believe that the Indian diaspora is not statecraft savvy or that we do not understand a strategy, I think they are all wrong, because we do have our strategies in place. And here are some of the examples. The radicalism of the Arthashastra, in the words of Max Weber, makes Machiavelli's The Prince looks harmless. Its emphasis on playing the military hardball and skill will certainly give realism a run for its money. Kautilya, ladies and gentlemen, reminds us with profound wisdom that without artha, economic well-being, and suraksha, that is security, there can be no dharma or righteousness. The well-known dictum of Sam, conciliation, dam, incentives, dand, punishment, and bhed, sowing discord in enemy ranks, is the strategic policy sense which urges us to pursue national interest with single-mindedness of our purpose and resolve through means fair or foul. Our think tanks and military institutions must undertake a comprehensive, in-depth study of these texts, conceptualize them to the needs of the modern statecraft, and propagate the consequential knowledge through structured programs. The same will help us to transit from the relative placidity of the past to greater sophistication and robustness of our strategic outlook. Much of this is already happening. If we could possibly do more, it will be of great help in addressing the security challenges that we will continue to face in our future. We are also recasting our strategic aspirations and defense outlook in a more real, pragmatic, and earthy frame through some creative doctrinal calibration enabled by a two-stage exercise. The National Security Strategy, a whole-of-government exercise, is indeed being undertaken by the Defense Planning Committee through an integrated examination of the strategic context, threats, opportunities, and the state of our economy to arrive at plausible scenarios and specific commitments. It will identify a tiered, prioritized matrix of national security challenges and risks that we must gear up for, based on likelihood and impact through a range of possibilities. Gray zone conflict, out-of-area contingencies, punitive and asymmetric deterrence of our competitors and adversaries, long-term balancing and the skillful leveraging of emerging domains, particularly in the fields of space, electronic warfare, cyber, and artificial intelligence, to just name a few. Given the ordering of risks and threats, identified capability deficits, and budgetary resources made available, it may be wise to carry a follow-up of the strategic defense review that could examine the various force structuring options before spelling out the specific combat capacities that it will resource. For those threats that cannot be addressed with combat force, non-kinetic risk mitigation options need to be developed with equal clarity. The restructuring of the higher defense organization may thereafter carry out further fine-tuning to produce two integrated perspective plans for the near and the long term, that is, perspective plans in the near term for 5 years and then in for the 10 years. A precise delivery schedule of combat capacities duly budgeted to replace the so-called LTIPP, which is the long-term integrated perspective plan that we have as of now, which is, in the absence of firm budgetary commitment, is a diminishing utility. So looking at our budget, I think we have to now start looking at how do we look at the perspective of the emerging military over the next 5 years and then subsequently over the next 10 years. Efficient defense is a function, amongst other factors, of the right allocations for defense, financial rigor, getting the best bang for the rupees that we spent on our defense, and a unified approach to war fighting. We are making a persuasive case for enhanced allocations for defense. The Indian Army, for one, has done a great deal by bringing in financial rigor and initiating structural organization. General Sheketkar has showed the way for us. He was tasked to do a study, and with that study we have followed through, and we are looking at addressing other issues and seeing how we can best optimize resources to get the best bang for the buck that we spend on defense. Through the mechanism of the integrated battle groups, we are transiting to lean, mean, agile, and task-oriented structures. A unified approach to war fighting has therefore become the order of the day. There is a dire need concurrently for all stakeholders in national security to align their thinking with modern sensibilities and sublime institutional interests in deterrence to the larger national purpose. So why are we carrying out this restructuring in the Indian Armed Forces? Ladies and gentlemen, we do understand that future wars will be lethal The weapon systems are becoming increasingly lethal. And therefore, you will have to look at getting victory in the shortest possible time frame if you do not want your own people to suffer casualties or damage. Therefore, if you have to achieve victory in a shorter time frame, you need leaner, meaner forces who can inflict damage on the adversary in a faster time frame, achieve the objectives of victory in a faster time frame, and then cause a collapse to the adversary in a faster mechanism so that the political objectives can be met before international pressures come on to you to go in for a ceasefire. So we have to start looking at that time frame when we embark into combat, if at all. Therefore, the national security must align thinking into the modern sensibilities and sublime institutional interests in deference to the larger national purpose. The necessity of constant evolution of higher defense organization to keep the challenges of modern war fighting cannot be overemphasized. So what we are trying to highlight is we need a higher defense organization to integrate the three services, because no single service can win battles in the future. It will have to be an integrated approach where all the three services will have to integrate along with the national resources if you have to win victory through quick combat. The essential wisdom of unification lies in integrating the military with the apex defense-making mechanisms of national security, as also amongst themselves, thus addressing both the strategic challenges of defense policy-making and the tactical needs of modern war fighting. One must not be pursued at the cost of the other. Both become equally critical. Concurrently, through the metric of jointmanship, there is much that we can do in the field to optimize capacities and costs. Our Honorable Prime Minister has exhorted the armed forces to prepare for integrated approach in our war fighting, to attend to our responsibilities that now extend beyond the borders and coastline for the protection of our critical interests and Indian citizens across the world. The security forces can be tasked to protect the Indian diaspora in any part of the world, as you have seen has happened in Syria, can happen in any other part of the world as well. The obvious military inference is for us to develop calibrated out-of-area contingency capabilities, which must of necessity be integrated structurally and in terms of unity of command. It is also for consideration that a lack of jointness in the field has led to duplication, oblique multiplication of assets in the areas of aviation, surveillance, communication, and most importantly, logistics, with naturally large burdens on the exchequer. In an age where network centricity and domain convergence are the building blocks for optimization, our focus on silo-based, single-service-driven vertical expansion, consequent to which communication surveillance networks of the three services cannot talk to each other, is just one example of the grim challenges that lie ahead and which need to be modified. Wisdom demands that we integrate military capacities in the field structurally with urgency, because competence and delivery in data structures is simply not possible. In terms of first principles in capacity building, we may consider the need to swivel from a purely threat-based approach to one driven by capabilities, or at least a happy mix of the two approaches. In the armed forces, we've been talking of developing our capabilities based on threat and capabilities, threat perceptions. In today's context, I think we need to look at an approach which is more capability-based, because it is difficult today to identify the nature of threats that one will be faced with. We know that there are various forms of warfare that are being adopted, grey zone warfare being amongst the few, non-contact warfare is what we talk of, and as technologies develop, the threat to military security will become more and more complex. Therefore, it is difficult to identify threat, and therefore I think you have to look at your capabilities. As was brought out, we are the third largest army in the world. I don't think we should be proud of being the third largest army in the world. We should be proud of becoming the largest army which is capable of technological innovation, which is capable of fighting the war with innovative means through technology transfusion. Our soldier must be empowered. So if we have to become the third largest, we must become the third largest in terms of technology, empowerment of our soldiers, and our capacities to do with the resources that are available to us, yet succeed in our mission. We will therefore have to be prepared for many strategic uncertainties, clashing visions, new fault lines, geopolitical flux, terror hotspots, vicissitudes in the global commons, and all that go with it. A capability-based approach advocates a broader range of possible scenarios for force developers to work on. It is also somewhat of a misnomer to believe that capability-based planning is devoid of any threat assessment whatsoever. It does, on the other hand, address strategic uncertainties with greater vigor, predicated on flexibility, adaptiveness, and robustness of capability to meet diverse threats and scenarios. A capability-based approach also takes into account the known and developable capacities of likely competitors in the near to long-term periods as against their known or assessed intent alone. It also addresses our current capability, future capability in the light of possible developable capacities of competitors, and most valuably, delineates capability deficits for planned scientific addressal. This is a concept that we must engage with greater diligence, which is bring in technology and scientifically address these in war fighting. What are we therefore looking at? We are looking at improving our capacities in what we call ISR, that is intelligence, surveillance, and reconnaissance. And in that, we must incorporate space-based assets. We are therefore investing greatly in our ISR capacity platforms, and the newly formed Defense Space Agency is also addressing a host of challenges from military-grade resolution for surveillance and targeting to revisit times, speedier downloading, and electronic spoofing. These become important, and therefore we are now looking at addressing at warfare from the space as well. Missiles, of which we have our missile man sitting here, Dr. Satish Reddy, is one issue which we must actually look at, because this will help us in getting non-contact warfare in the way we want to conduct war. It is deterrence from long ranges without directly getting involved in combat. We are, however, aggregating capabilities in terms of tandem and armed UAV systems, loiter munitions, as also missiles, with improved guidance and tracker technologies. And we are very happy in the manner in which our DRDO is moving ahead in missile technology, both at the short range and longest ranges. A major weakness in recent times, however, has been the suboptimal leveraging of technocentric combat through tools like electronic warfare. Our exploitation of the electromagnetic spectrum has not kept abreast with the pace of technological change and the scale of leveraging. We are addressing this infirmity, and this is very important that we address the use of the electromagnetic spectrum in the next 10 years if we want to become a techno-savvy army. Now we come on to international engagements. You know, we must develop international engagements to ensure that the power politics that is being played in the region and outside, we bring it into spacecraft through military means. While delivering the keynote address at the Shangri-La Dialogue on 1st June 18, our Honorable Prime Minister Shri Narendra Modi laid out the postulates of our global engagements in terms of a catchy fiver. When he said the five S's, he said, we must focus on Samman, respect for all, Samvad through dialogue, Shanti and Sayog in the spirit of peace and cooperation, and Samriddhi, that is for our collective prosperity. The five levers must also be sheeted in the frame of a wider vision for our defense and for our security. Our defense diplomacy, therefore, is working resolutely to complement our foreign policy initiative. The respect, even admiration that the Indian Armed Forces command among military worldwide for their professionalism and domain expertise is being leveraged purposefully. Military officers from friendly foreign countries often make the point that they prefer to come to Indian military training institutions because of the quality of our curriculum and the depth of our training protocols. So great is the yearning for vacancies in Indian military training institutions that some countries have instituted a special entrance test for aspirants wishing to do courses in our training establishments. Given the salience of militaries in the power structures in our neighborhood, we need to energize military-to-military contacts significantly, and therefore military diplomacy is becoming the new buzzword in this arena. Some of the initiatives that are taking place in our country to engage military through diplomacy, for diplomacy, is through in the forums like RUSI, the Shangri-La Dialogue and the Raisina Dialogue, which are held almost every year or every alternate year. Leveraging the softer attributes of the military will not only strengthen deterrence, but will also enhance our strategic power in the area of our influence. Nation defense strategy must be bolstered through appropriate messaging of our strategic communication and resolute action by way of information operations. Therefore, it is important that the military and the media integrate and carry and send the same message across. It requires all media and communications to be coordinated and synchronized so that you send a coherent message sans any contradictions which may violate the stated narrative. In today's information age, mere action is not good enough. We must develop compelling counter-narratives to challenge and undermine the adversary's pitch. A great deal of work is already on in this domain. Information maneuver is the integration of modern informational capabilities such as cyber and digital media with other traditional forms of warfare. To control the information sphere, enhance influence to also tackle the new WMD. And with WMD, I do not mean weapons of mass destruction, but words of mass disinformation. Because there is sophistry, there is fake news, and post-truth in the digital age. This is what we have to do conjointly with the media and military working in tandem. The salience of the informational realm in modern military combat is exemplified by this nugget from Mosul. The turning point in the defeat of the Daesh was conjointly the ability of the local resistance and the West in mastering information. Daesh in Mosul, that is the ISIS, was not defeated by destroying the tanks and the aircraft. They were defeated by destroying the $50 Daesh media kiosks. And by just destroying these kiosks, you destroyed the Daesh and the ISIS. It's because the media and communication is what you hit at, and that is what failed them. So in the midst of our own right-sizing and optimization initiatives, therefore, we are laying great stress on information maneuver. We are creating specialists that are adept at using non-lethal means and unorthodoxy in the field to attain ascendancy over our adversaries' informational activity and to modify adversaries' behavior. The number of initiatives that have been taken to infuse the defense manufacturing ecosystem is the defense corridors that are being set up, one in the north in Uttar Pradesh and one in the south in Tamil Nadu, which will encourage and boost defense manufacturing in India through the private industry. As you have seen in America, it is the Silicon Valley which is developing various trends for the American Army. And similarly, I think we have to start leveraging the industry to start looking at artificial intelligence through our MSMEs, through our R&D labs, through our academia and military startups. So therefore, what have we embarked upon? In the military, we are now engaging with the academia, with our IITs. That is why I think I am here today in the University of Mumbai to scout for talent from the very bright brains that are sitting here to see how we can leverage the academia in ensuring our military might and enabling our forces to be combat ready for the future. And with this, the MAKE initiative, which seeks to galvanize and indigenize defense manufacturing ecosystem, is doing some outstanding work in this regard. I am quite confident that some of our startups will emerge from amongst you who are sitting here in the audience. Technological change in the military realm is so rapid and necessary is no longer the mother of invention. Technological embrace in the military realm, however, has many facets. There are big ticket technologies like those related to next generation fighter, carrier aviation, hypersonic weapons and all, challenges that are being addressed through numerous DRDO projects. These obtain, however, a slew of technologies of the low-hanging variety, as although those with game-changing potential, which we need to pursue with equal resolve. There is considerable scope for leveraging low-hanging technology and for speedy induction into our armed forces, and we have therefore created an Army Design Bureau, which has come out with problem statements as to what are the issues that need to be addressed and what are the technologies that the Indian Army and the Indian Armed Forces are looking at. And the initiative that we have taken is doing well because we are now hand-holding with the academia, with the industry, with our R&D establishments and have made some good rapid strides. Concurrently, there is a need to embrace the elements of the fourth industrial revolution, that is the materials, technological and the chips, which will drive combat at hyper speeds and fundamentally alter the nature of combat. It is not without reason that China has resolved to be the leader in artificial intelligence by 2035, the effort being spearheaded by initiatives like Anbot Robocop. The American robotics design company Boston Dynamics, after developing robots that can open doors and backflip, is now focusing on mounting guns on them and making them sneak about the battlefield. The US Army has also managed to develop reconnaissance robots with remote intervention capacities, shooting from safe distances. We have embarked on a similar drive. Artificial intelligence solutions to linguistic challenges are being leveraged for instant translation of Mandarin intercepts. Software-assisted analysis of social, electronic, print, and digital media will be used to arrive at intelligent assessments of the adversary intent. Therefore, artificial intelligence tools will also be leveraged to develop adversary intent assessment compendiums with wider applicability and greater spectrum across the combat zone. We are also pursuing AI projects in fire control, predictive maintenance, and health diagnostics. We today live in an age of disruptions. The practice of disruptive leadership has also technological, organizational, and thought disruptions. The modern adage by way of response is that if you don't innovate, you will evaporate. We are determined to foster the spirit of innovation and improvisation to stay ahead in strategic competition. And you will be surprised the kind of innovation that we are getting from college and university students is indeed very encouraging. We have sent some of the IIT students from IITs, Chennai, including Mumbai, Kolkata, Kharagpur to be precise, to our forward areas. And they have come out with some wonderful solutions through technology innovations to address some of the complex situations which are concerning us, especially in the fields of surveillance and communication. Military innovation is all about staying ahead of events, revisiting organizational ethos, thinking about challenges and competitions through differentiated thinking in tactics, strategy, organization structures, technology, and adaptations. Ladies and gentlemen, you will be happy to know that through innovations, we have been able to get an IPR for the Indian Army, and this is in the field of bulletproofing, where one of our own military students, along with the academia, that is IIT in Chennai, has been able to get an IPR registered in their name for bulletproofing, and the bulletproof vests and clothing that we are making now has an IPR in the name of the Indian Army. So this is what I am trying to highlight. It's just the beginning of what we are seeing in the future. And therefore, ladies and gentlemen, finally, in conclusion, I would like to say that we are now transiting from a balancing to a leveraging power. The national security mind space seems to be ready more than ever before for change and for some decisive forward movement. In recent times, we have proved ourselves that for far too long, we were perhaps punching well below our weight. Responses to Uri and Pulwama were significantly more robust as against our inaction after 26/11. Having questioned many of our tardy assumptions of the past and substitute the same with purposeful action, we are sanguine that we are well poised now to chart a new trajectory in national security. We are resolved to make India so strong that our people prosper and India rises to its place and promise in the world. Thank you for a very patient hearing, ladies and gentlemen, and Jai Hind.